Hello and welcome to the lecture Governance in the Digital Age, the States of Affairs, Opportunities and Challenges for the Board of Directors. Before we start, let me introduce myself. My name is Fabio Oliveira, I am a visiting lecturer and a PhD researcher in Hanyu Business School. I have many years of professional experiences in management and leadership positions in sales and marketing, working for companies such as Xerox, Toshiba, Laureate International Universities, University of Hertfordshire, and Electrolux, both in Brazil and in England. For the last 14 years, I've been teaching part-time marketing, sales, leadership, and management for MBA and master courses in the UK and Brazil. I have an extensive academic background, and actually, I am a certified Huawei instructor of artificial intelligence in the HCI level at ICT Huawei Academy in the University of Reading Hanlin Business School. And during the next 1 hour, I will be sharing with you something about my research and as well my professional experience working for companies and sitting in a board of directors management position. In this video, we will understand the role of the board of directors, specifically in the UK, and we will know the actual composition of the board in terms of age, gender, and the non-duality of chair and CEO, as well the importance of non-executive directors. We'll discuss different perspectives that informs the way board of director works, being the theories of agency, stewardship, and resource dependence. Once you are familiar with the responsibilities and who are the members of a board, we'll talk about the way boards decide and the profile and behavior of board members while they are making decisions and strategies. At the end of the video, we will be presented by a big question. A big question that I will invite you to think about, provoke your critical think, and a way forward for you to suggest actions that you may believe to be important for boards, adaptation to the modern corporate and business environment that we are calling now digital age. So, let us move forward. Our first step is towards the conceptualization and basic understanding about the board of directors' responsibilities and the reasons for companies to have corporate governance, a good corporate governance. Corporate governance covers the systems, rules, and process to direct corporate activity. Broader descriptions encompass the relationship of the corporation to all its stakeholders and society, and include the sets of laws, regulations, the listing rules, and voluntary private sector's practices that enable corporations to attract capital, perform efficiently, generate profit, of course, and meet both legal obligations and general societal expectations. From a board legal perspective, the board of a public corporation is responsible for setting a corporation's policy and directions, and as well electing and appointing executive directors to act on behalf of the corporation, and acting on other significant matters that affects the corporation. Therefore, corporate governance is of the public domain interest, as the decisions of public companies' directors and their actions have a direct impact in the wealth of stakeholders and the whole environment in which company operates. For taking the most critical decisions in the enterprise, leading it to the success or the failure. The decisions board members make are high-level decisions, such as mergers and acquisitions, new investments, and manufacturing, key suppliers and divestments. Therefore, these decisions are the long-term wealth of the companies, affecting all the aspects of these firms. The board and its committees have the power to appoint and fire executives that run the daily business activities. Therefore, the relationship between board members and the executive team are crucial to the alignment between the big strategies and the daily actions that CEOs and the executive team members perform on behalf of the board. Yet, the board has the fiduciary responsibility regarding the executive team, and legal duties involving the norms, laws, and rules defined by regulator bodies and the governments. For example, the GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation, and Comply or Explain, that are principles-based code that requires the company to state that it has complied with the requirements of the code or to explain why it could not do so in its annual report. This will leave stakeholders and shareholders to draw their own conclusions regarding the governance of the company. One important body is the Financial Reporting Council that sets the UK Corporate Governance and Stewardship Codes and UK standards for accounting and actuarial work. It monitors and takes action to promote the quality of corporate reporting and operates independent enforcement arrangements for accountants and actuaries. As the competent authority for auditing in the UK, the FRC sets auditing and ethical standards and monitors and enforces audit quality. Now that you know the expectations that society and shareholders have towards board of directors and as well the regulators, the rules and the laws that the board needs to follow, there are many different theories and approaches to corporate governance, and the role of the board changes accordingly. For the context of digital technology's impacts on board of directors, we will focus on three main theories: the agency theory, the stewardship theory, and the resource dependence theory. Let us start with the agency theory. The classic agency theory considers the board as being subordinated to shareholders as first-order agent. However, from a law perspective, the board has the power to act on behalf of the shareholders. The central role of the board is to oversee managers to ensure that their interests do not diverge from those of the principals, the shareholders, and take actions that maximize principals' return. But the process of managing creates conflicts between these parts, and from these conflicts emerges most of the conceptual discussions with efforts to minimize conflicts and establish motivator factors that can augment the engagement of the top management team. Contradicting the agency theory is the stewardship theory that minimizes the existence of conflicts between shareholders' interests and management and draws attention to true and honest relationship between the parts, and top management team achieving results by other motivator factors rather than and the belief in insiders, directors, and CEO share duality, which is not the case in the UK, as we will see in the board composition section. Therefore, stewardship theory assumes that the use of formal controls such as monitoring and incentive compensation systems are unnecessary and potentially counterproductive for the best results of the executive team. In other words, stewardship assumes that directors will strive to achieve results that meet their short-term goals, at the same time meeting shareholders' interests, by no means of only economic motivators, but by other factors, including financial rewards too. The role of the board in a stewardship perspective is to be a mentor, follow up closely to the execution of the strategy to guarantee that alignment exists between the parts. As a consequence of this approach, board members must know how the operational aspects of the company works to better understand how to contribute to value creation for the company. But this is not that simple to be executed, as the actual board composition does not facilitate this perspective. We'll talk more about it during the lecture. The last perspective I want to share with you is the resource dependency theory that focuses on the relations with the external environment rather than ones with the company in shaping organizational behavior and the board as the main link to bring resources from external relationships to the company. This approach attempts to identify how to make boards work better. In my opinion, this is the most comprehensive perspective, as it requires from board members to have an holistic view of the company's operations needs to understand, assess, and evaluate the opportunities and risks in the environment in which the company operates. And doing that, establish partnerships with other companies and resource providers to enhance capabilities and capacities of the company. Now that you have some understanding of the perspectives informing the board of directors' actions, let us know how this board of directors are represented today in the UK. Now, it's important to understand the actual board composition of the majority of boards in the UK, which might reflect, in some extent, the global reality regarding to the challenges and opportunities. Data from the UK Spencer Board Index, which is a comprehensive review of governance practice in the largest 150 companies in the FTSE rankings, provides a valuable perspective on the health of boardrooms. This index indicates that these boards meet in average 7.6 times a year to carry out their duties and responsibilities. And in reality, in some sectors, as education, board meetings are around 4 to 5 times a year, with length of meetings vary from 4 to 8 hours. Another characteristic to consider is the average age of board members, which is 60 years old for non-executive directors and 54.3 years old for executive directors. In the United States, research shows that for companies in the S&P 500, 80% have directors aged 60 years old, and less than 5% of directors are aged 50 years old or young, and 21% of directors are aged 70 years older. Another important aspect of board composition is that in the UK there is no duality in the role of CEO and chair of the boards, which, in my opinion, in contrary of the United States, is an excellent model, and it brings more debate and autonomy to the boards. But only 8% are full-timer chairs, and only 3.3% of the chairs are women, while 30.6% of the total board members being women. If you want to know more details about board composition, I invite you to read the full report that I made available. But for the context of this lecture, I believe these four characteristics, being age, meetings, per year, non-duality, and gender set the stage for introducing the way the body decides and strategizes, as well the behavior of these demographics while making strategic decisions. So, let's move forward. The procedures and norms of board meetings have not changed too much since the 19th century, meaning an approach that encourages careful deliberation of issues before making final decisions. The process of a board meeting can be summarized in three phases. Firstly, the definition of the topics and problems to be raised, debated, and deliberated during the meetings. Secondly, the top management team prepares the papers that will provide information and data to support the deliberations. These papers are compiled into a board pack, which then the secretary sends it to each board member, and typically, board members receive the board pack within a few days before the meeting occurs, sometimes giving board members few time to digest all the pack, which consists in average of 200 to 250 pages of figures, data, facts, and considerations made by the executive team. During the meeting, board members debate with executives and between them about the problems, strategies, and after classifications, clarifications, deliberations, and questioning. After all these tasks, a decision is made, and then the executive team must adhere and execute the decisions. Although it is a simple and straightforward process, in practice, it involves a set of distinctive characteristics that it is worth to mention. The first is information gathering, sharing, assessment with big data, mobile communication, machine learning, and other digital tools have impacted both in the quantity, quality, and understanding and insights extracted from the information. And recent studies found evidence of cognitive biases, cognitive overloading, and disruptions in the strategic decision-making, which we will discuss more later. Secondly, it is related to the hidden agenda of board members, meaning self-interests, focus on short-term results, and fit with the pace of changes. Thirdly, it is related to the readiness of board members to cope with the speed of change, digital technology features such as quantity, velocity, complexity, and the merge of new competitors in the market. But the board members' decision-making process is still the same as always, meaning logical, pragmatic, and not fast enough to keep up with the current business environment. Our lecture, we will explore the consequences of the digital technology on these features, these characteristics, and it will bring to you the contemporary thinking and latest findings about these challenges and opportunities that is published. Corporate governance has always been a challenging job, but there has likely never been a time when serving on a board has been more challenging and demanding than right now. Board oversight is charged with more risk than ever before, with directors having to confront a wide array of increasingly complex pressures from both inside and outside the company. An unpredictable geopolitical, environmental, economical, and social climate, workplace misconduct, allegations against companies that haven't adequately protected customer data, activist shareholders working to replace or augment board directors with new and more diverse talent. Regardless of this complexity, the deliberation model of decision-making is no longer suitable for this environment. Directors are expected to be able to respond instantly to any situation that comes to their way, with little tolerance from stakeholders and other shareholders for anything other than swift and positive outcomes. Directors are judged on their speed of action and their ability to accurately predict what is going on to happen in an environment defined by unpredictability. A slow decision-making process is not likely to be valued in an era best defined by Moore's Law, in which the speed of technological innovation and data processing nearly doubles every 18 months. In this digital age, investors, shareholders, and other stakeholders expect instant results and have precious little patience for boards who take material time for careful consideration and reflection. And even though directors meet a couple of times a year, they must accept responsibility for the overall success or failure of the companies. But the fact that the vast majority of board members are not digital natives is only part of the problem. Recent research from Deloitte estimates that only 170% of S&P 500 companies' directors have technology expertise. This lack of technology expertise are twice as likely to outperform the S&P 500 index by as much as 10%. These issues and challenges makes me raise for you the first big question. Let's see. In other words, what specific practices are companies using to help their directors gain the thoughtful insights needed to make complex decisions while moving at the speed of a tweet? What should directors know about how governance practices are evolving in response to digital disruption and technological innovation? And most importantly, if directors find their boards are not keeping pace with digital age demands, what practical solutions can they implement to gain advantage? I invite you to reflect and search for answers to these questions. In the next slides, I will provide to you the available data from publications and from my own experience that document some of the changes in corporate governance due to the digital age. Let's move forward. Thank you, and see you in the next video.